Testament lesson this morning is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 2. It's found on page 631 in your pew Bible. Isaiah chapter 2, beginning with verse 1. The word that Isaiah the son of Amos saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. In days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be raised above the hills. All the nations shall stream to it. Many peoples shall come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths." For out of Zion shall go forth instruction, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations, and shall arbitrate for many peoples. They shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. Our epistle lesson today is from the book of Romans. Page 162 in your pew Bible, and it's Romans chapter 13, beginning with verse 11. An urgent appeal. Besides this, you know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in reveling and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. And our gospel lesson is from the book of Matthew, chapter 24. And that's on page 27 in the New Testament. Matthew 24, beginning with verse 36, the necessity for watchfulness. But about that day and hour, no one knows, neither the angels of heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. For as the days of Noah were, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing until the flood came and swept them all away. So too will be the coming of the Son of Man. Then two will be in the field. One will be taken and one will be left. Two women will be grinding meal together. One will be taken and one will be left. Keep awake, therefore, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Therefore, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. Word of the Lord, thanks be to God.
From Parade magazine comes the story of self-made millionaire Eugene Land, who greatly changed the lives of a sixth grade class in East Harlem. Mr. Lang had been asked to speak to this class of 59 sixth graders. What could he say that it would inspire these students, most of whom would drop out of school? He wondered how he could get these predominantly underprivileged children to even listen to what he had to say. Frustrated, he scraps his notes and decides to speak from the heart. "Stay in school," he says, "and I'll help pay the college tuition for every one of you." For the first time ever, these students were offered hope. Hope for the future. One student says it like this: "I had something to look forward to, something waiting for me. It was a golden feeling." Nearly 90% of that class would go on to graduate high school. It's easy to be like these 59 students who lost focus on hope and fell into the trap of complacency, of doing nothing. Complacency can happen to us when we are unaware. In today's world, we are so busy, we leave ourselves little time to see what God may have to say to us, to sit quietly and listen to God's voice as God may be speaking to us. I am guilty of this. Today marks the beginning of Advent, a time when for many this begins the busiest season of the year, a time when it's easy to get caught up in all the celebration preparations that we simply forget to stay focused on the hope offered in Jesus' coming birth. Like I said, I am guilty of this. I am guilty of being wrapped up in preparing for all these celebrations that I easily lose sight of the hope of the coming of Christ. In today's text, Jesus is concerned about the likely possibility that his disciples will lose hope in his coming again, and rightfully so. Go with me here for a second. I am a disciple of Jesus. I just heard Jesus predict the destruction of the temple. No stone, not one stone, will be left upon another. The temple, the only deep connection we have left under this Roman rule, the only deep connection to our God, and it is going to be utterly destroyed. And on top of that, you're telling me there's more suffering, more wars, more famine. It is going to be as bad as childbirth pains. And all of this has to happen before you come again? Haven't we suffered enough? But then Jesus, in the beginning of this passage, begins by explaining about his coming again. "But about that day, the day that I come again, and the hour that I come again, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father." Jesus goes on again and reminds them of his coming four more times in these nine short verses, only a small portion of Jesus' greater speech in Matthew. I think there's an importance in this. He's saying, forget about all that bad stuff that I just mentioned and focus on the hope of my coming again. But Jesus has more to say. He always has more to say than just have hope. He warns his disciples not to lose focus on this hope. He starts by saying, "For as in those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day Noah entered the ark, and even they knew nothing until the flood came and swept them all away." What struck me here is it's not their sinfulness or unbelief that rather, it is their busyness of daily routine human activities that lead to their loss of hope in God. He continues this pattern of focusing on routine activities with two more parables: two men working in the field and two women grinding meal. What Jesus is suggesting here is that his followers are not to be so attentive to these daily activities, to what may be going on in the world around us, that they unintentionally forget the hope of his coming again. Jesus then continues his discourse by a fourth parable about alertness and preparedness. One is to be prepared so as not to let the thief break in. Now, in this case, I would suggest you think of the thief as the loss of hope, because the loss of hope leads to complacency. Jesus says, therefore, be ready. He is reminding his disciples that they are losing the hope of what it means that he will come again, because they are so wrapped up in these human activities. But before he moves on from this discourse, he offers this last reminder that the Son of Man is coming again. Be ready, because the Son of Man is coming, at an unexpected hour. The coming again of Christ can offer us the same hope that the first coming of Christ offered the Jews under that oppressive Roman rule. As we begin the season of Advent, may we be reminded of the hope of the coming of Christ. Having hope in the coming of Christ is a wonderful thing to remember, and it can offer us relief when we get caught up in the busyness of life. But as Jesus points out in his final parable, this hope can't just end there. We are called to action. Action in the waiting of the coming of Christ. The final parable Jesus in this text explains a tremendous amount by its symbolism. The head is the household, and it represents the human soul. The thief, in this case, as I mentioned before, is the loss of hope. The body, the house is the body. The doors are the mouth and the ears. The windows, the eyes. And like a thief would enter a real house, through the doors and the windows, so complacency can creep easily into our lives, causing us to lose sight of the hope of the coming of Christ. Jesus suggests that you avoid this loss of hope by being alert and prepared. How can one be alert and prepared, you ask? Well, you start by bolting your doors, by guarding what the mouth says that may be hurtful, divisive, or damaging to one another. Let the windows of your eyes make you aware of the needs of others around you and respond to those needs. If one is alert and prepared, they will easily notice when God reveals the needs of God's people. And just like Eugene Land, the self-made millionaire who offered hope to 59 Harlem students, Jesus offers Christian hope by reminding them that he is coming again. Have hope. Live into hope. Act on that hope, because I am coming again. I am is coming again. For the sake of the gospel and the sake of the world. Amen.